one of the drawings that came out was from the window, and what they wanted to see out of the window and what they were actually seeing. By the end of all these discussions, it culminated into this a walkthrough floating house. This is a photograph from the exhibition, and there are different objects floating. The insides and the outside walls collapse to form these beautiful installations from photography, textile, and we spoke about prenatal health, we spoke about contraceptives of the bed, we spoke about domestic violence, what a dirty picture was, what a good picture was, what they wanted, what their aspirations was. So this is the gas.
Can you help
and that's
me?
How after like making that drawing, that's what it ended up as.
Or can you help us?
She's made like a mandap, like in Indian weddings you have like these little decorations around the fire. And so on the left side, you have this spot where basically she has a happy day and she's cooked this food and she's taken pictures of a happy day. And on the left side, she's burned the pictures of all her food, post experiencing domestic violence and nobody eating food in the house and experiencing violence. And that's her body sort of shifting from a bright to a dark sort of space. These are the different stories that were captured in Dharavi by the ladies themselves, where they interviewed different women about domestic violence. We also spoke about food, nutrition, health, every aspect, whether it was the kitchen, what's good food, what's unhealthy food, which was part of Sneha. These were some of the photographs taken of the issues from the photography group. And the women, by the end of it, decided to sort of name all these and title their works by Bollywood picture names. Bollywood is a big string of, I think it's an escapism in a form, because there is a lot being dealt in the area itself. And every Indian picture watches their Salman Khan or Amitabh Bachchan, sort of, there are a lot of derivatives from this. So Dirty Picture basically, and this is a story of an old woman who is sort of thrown out of her house, and there are no old age homes, so she sits opposite her house and looks at her children every day walking in and out. So there is a lot of problems happening in Dharavi itself, and this platform was given for these women to express. Why I started out with this was because it was really nice to come back into the country and ground myself in a body of work and engage with the community. It would sort of give me a more in-depth sense of how I would be developing the next phase from my filmmaking phase. So this was a little exercise that I did, was like to put your feet in someone else's shoes, and I said you are free to imagine whatever you feel like, and these are like dream slippers and what their dreams are. So someone wanted a laptop and wanted to learn how to use a laptop, and therefore the shoes have a laptop. Someone wanted to travel the world, and therefore you have Google slippers with the planet. A lot of them wanted gardens and parks, which are totally missing from the urban design landscape. Somebody wanted to just fly in a plane, which is on the top left corner. We spoke about health issues, and this was part of like sugar and the effects of sugar, and that's a Bollywood film called Chini Kam, which also means less sugar. So for the past 10 years, I've been living between India and New Zealand. My family is based there, and I sort of go and visit them, and then I come back here. And this is a view from Bandra, where I live. And I would go back to New Zealand, and then I would come back here again and see this. And part of me was like, what's missing in the day-to-day habits is basically we have lost in touch with nature. And why are we lost in touch with nature is because we've got the same habits, but the materials have been replaced. So if we would have tea, it would be in a mud cup, but now it's been replaced by plastic. And what you're seeing, these beaches, we used to swim in it 20 years back. And it's something that I wouldn't even mention it right now. And it's called Dark Waters because it's filled with sewage. So drawing inspiration from this kind of dichotomy of existence that I live between, I started building these biospheres. And the first one that I experimented on was called Element Earth. Now, the purpose of Element Earth was to fully build a sustainable biosphere. I was inspired by biomimicry. I wanted to talk about this to people. So on the right side, you see a solar cell tree. And the idea was that the solar cell tree would parse sounds of the earth. And the sounds of the earth were divided into five different phases, which was atmosphere, water, surface, core. And then basically, it got activated. The idea was that the solar cell tree would activate and the sounds would start playing. And then when someone moved around this body, sounds, human sounds would get overlaid. So it was a constantly changing sound environment in there, which was being powered by solar energy. But that was what I imagined, and this was when I was making this 2011. The solar cell tree had, the cells were too small. I put 50 cells and it did not generate enough electricity. So, and why I'm talking about all of this is because there is a huge gap between technology and what exactly is reaching your point and what they're trying to make and create. And but I started making these circuit boards. So this was, now if print circuit boards, it does not like organic images. So what you've seen is a test image where spiel, which means to play, I was routing it and it would not make the image. And then I started realizing the materiality dictated a lot in the way our circuit boards and electronics were being created. So this is a software that I use, which is used to design circuit boards, and I was designing plants in there. And then basically a copper film is placed on the acrylic and I sensitively the image and etch it, and that's how the image is transferred. But it's not very eco-friendly. So I started looking for ways and means how I could make this methodology more environment-friendly, because it really starts from the studio, your material interaction and what your philosophy and your concepts are. Element Earth basically included functional artwork. So it had boards which like functioned, and this is where the sound was made. This is the solving of the solar cell tree. I'm just going to play you a video. I just realized, I forgot to mention what biomimicry was. Does anyone know what biomimicry is here? So biomimicry is a philosophy where you look at nature and look at nature as a technology, because nature's already resolved most of its issues. It's a self-sustaining environment. So if our technology observed nature and mimicked it, and some examples are like Velcro, or like how this whirl of the water is water, or like how the plane was invented by looking at birds. So basically here, basically I was trying to create an electronic-led sustainable environment. I'm also trying to explore if later on the glass itself, where I can put dyes on it and make the glass itself a solar panel. So these are all experiments that are in process. Simultaneously, I started making more biospheres, and the next one is called Polymorphic Human Scape. And being a filmmaker, I started like putting small films inside bottles. They're interactive. So basically, this is about urban design. A lot of construction and fabrication that is happening in India. The cities are happening quite under. It's massive, fast industrial progression, like development, and architecture is not taken into consideration. Sound is not green. Ecology is. There are no trees left in Bombay anyway. The sewage systems haven't been taken care of. So in these pieces, basically, if it doesn't sense a movement, it plays one day in nature from morning to night. And as soon as it senses a human motion around it, it changes into Bombay, a city which has become a machine and just producing and developing. But what gets very interesting with these pieces are the people who come and help me make these pieces. It's just not a singular person. There are people who are preparing televisions, you know. They're no longer, a lot of them basically are losing their jobs because nobody is repairing stuff anymore in India also. This whole wave of issues related to electronics is coming into spectrum. That's first the motion sensor being activated. A lot of people, a range of people connect with it, whether it's children to like old people, everybody wants to play because technology has a sense of seduction. We are all sort of drawn to it, but at the same time it's changing the way behavior patterns in society are sort of developing, or like how different ecological revelation, you know, issues are sort of taking place. The speed at which things are changing, we are all overwhelmed in some form or the other. And there's a lot of data that is floating out of the internet. I feel like in these pieces I was just beginning to understand the possibilities of technology, and then I started sort of exploring something called the emotive sounds of the electric writer. Because my interest in community and technology needed to be bridged in more stronger, and I was wondering how exactly to involve people on a more direct sort of spectrum. And because of all the travels that I was doing, I was feeling quite disconnected from reality. My only space of interaction was becoming social media, and I was never in one place too long. So what I decided to do was, I decided to basically invite people to write letters, but letters with love to any object, subject of your choice. It could be a political party, it could be a pixel, it could be a chocolate, it could be... But these love letters were about how do you communicate to bring about change. And so I provided this as an example, where someone wrote a love letter to NSA. And I sent it out to around 80 odd people, and I got around 560 letters from across the planet in different languages. And these are some of the letters. And then what I did was I got a machine, which is I hacked into a plotter, and the plotter would basically try and copy these handwritings. So when they would copy these handwritings, not because the machine was old, it would like follow across the curve and then stop. And then I was like, that's very interesting. I'm going to use a pen to bleed into the paper to record the thinking of the machine. So what happened was across different handwritings and different interactions, I got these dots all across the paper. And that's the machine, the little plotter, which prints the scroll. So what basically what I landed up from those 50 letters was having this huge scroll, and I could then send it out to different musicians, scan the whole scroll, made it into a video, and basically 70 people made a sound piece. The project is ongoing. As it moves from place to place, I can sort of get different letters and I can print out different scores and invite different musicians to collaborate and co-create this piece. So it's like inspired of John Cage's chant score in a way, and his philosophies of that, but in its own way, it produces by chance and scores through the interactions of the viewers. So, about a new piece that I'm right now in process. It's got to do with data and data visualization. It's called Osmoscape, Echoes of the Osmotic Landscape. Now, because of my interest in information, and I found myself organizing data over the internet, I wanted data to be more meaningful. Because currently, we're just sort of lost in, there's a lot of information from different cultures appearing. And I wanted it to be more meaningful and engaging for people. So I started building musical scores out of research data related to water pollution. And I tell the story of water through a graphical notation score. So I'm just going to be explaining what the process of data summification is. This is of a website where I found these data sets, their numbers. And then we used processing, which was a coding form, and created all these visuals. And that's the different kinds of rainfall in different cities in India. But the data that I've collected is actually from planet Earth, because water is like this giant motorway across the planet. And I started building this score, which is related to sound. And finally, the score started developing. This is just a section of it. And we are now developing it into a web app. It will be a sculpture, it will be an app. It will be a book. So, this has taken me nearly 3 years to collect. collect 55 data sets and have different sounds with them. So I'm going to just continue talking because this will take a while to load. The idea is that people can augment the information and explore what each story and different case studies from across the planet have. And the story of water starts from the atomic structure of water, because you know, water by its nascent, it's the universal solvent. And one of the main reasons it's the universal solvent is because it seeks balance. It's partially charged and it wants to connect with everything. And while it connects with everything, it sort of takes, whether it's pollutant, whether it's information, whether it's memories, it sort of travels across this planet, regurgitating in this giant circle. And as said by a lot of people, we may be even drinking dinosaur's piss. And I found that really fascinating. What I decided to do was tell the story of water in 7 chapters, and it starts from the atomic structure of water going to the current state of the planet, and from the current state of the planet it follows the route of the water from space, glaciers, and it goes down to the river, and different case studies related to pollution across that. It's really sad that I can't show you this because there's some beautiful soundscapes that have been designed, and the idea is that the audience can actually create their own sounds on this score. So there are buttons which appear on the data itself, and as you engage with it, given the data is programmed, the buttons can engage with the sound, and you as an audience can create your own sonic landscape. We have to realize that our body, as well as the landscape outside, is all interconnected, and how and the information and the technology that we put out there impacts the body as well as the so the idea is through sound I wanted to connect different information related to this. Sorry, this is still a prototype phase. So, one of the things I've realized is when you're immersed in an immersive reality and you're able to engage, information sort of travels through a very sensorial understanding. And that sensorial understanding comes from sound, touch, skin. And it sort of travels through your cognition. And through the cognition, basically, an idea is formed from cultural history as well as your present understanding. And once, rather than being overtly didactic around artworks and giving too much information to people, using senses as a way of governing and manufacturing ideas and telling stories through it is a very beautiful way of talking about environmental issues which are existing across the planet. And I'm hoping this would go on. The internet's a bit too slow out here. My stuff is not really good. But yeah, this is what I'm aiming for. And the idea is that people then can engage and read an e-book, which is the whole story of water, and make their own soundscapes while developing this structure. So I think this is it.
Okay, thank you, Nandita, for your we have some audience questions, but yeah, we are unfortunately running out of time, but we encourage you to talk to the artists after this if you have any further questions. And now